Walking through betrayals. What do you do when you've been betrayed often? When those you trusted are the same people that made a fool of you or told such painful lies about you. The dictionary defines betrayal as violation of a person's trust or confidence, and this explains why it can hurt really bad when our confidence in people is trampled on. The painful thing about the days we live in is that betrayals have become so common, and that is scary, right? Betrayal is so painful that it could lead to depression and can even be fatal. Betrayal erodes trust and destroys relationships. It wrecks families and ruins even business relationships. Amazingly, it can happen anywhere: family, friends, workplaces, and even in the church. And one of the reasons why betrayal is so painful is because we really thought we actually mattered to the people that betrayed us. However, one of the easiest ways to push back the pain of betrayal is to know and constantly remember that the devil is the originator of these kind of issues. He wants us feeling disillusioned, unhappy, bitter, and hopeless, so that we are cut off from God's plan for our lives. So he tempts someone close to you to say or do something that puts you in a very bad light. He influences their emotions, stirring up bitterness, strife, and envy in that person, till all they think of is how to get back at you or use you to achieve something that is selfish. There are 5 different forms of betrayals. Greed-driven betrayal. It is a betrayal that starts with someone hurting you because of how it will benefit them personally. Using the incentive for them is a promise of money or promotion. The story of Samson and Delilah is a graphic example of greed-driven betrayal. It is well captured in Judges 16:5. So the 5 lords, governors of the Philistines, came to her and said to her, "Persuade him and see where his great strength lies, and find out how we may overpower him so that we may bind him to subdue him. And each of us will give you 1,100 pieces of silver." So Delilah said to Samson, "Please tell me where your great strength lies, and with what you may be bound and subdued." Delilah was offered 1,100 pieces of silver, each by 5 governors, in return for her help in getting the secret of Samson's strength and how to subdue him. Judges 16:15. Then she said to him, "How can you say, 'I love you,' when your heart is not with me? You have mocked me these 3 times and have not told me where your great strength lies." When she pressured him day after day with her words and pleaded with him, he was annoyed to death. Then finally he told her everything that was in the heart and said to her, "A razor has never been used on my head, for I have been a Nazarite to God from my mother's womb. If I am shaved, then my strength will leave me, and I will become weak and be like any other man." Then Delilah realized that he had told her everything in his heart, so she sent and called for the Philistine lords, saying, "Come up this once, because he has told me everything in his heart." Then the Philistine lords came up to her and brought the money they had promised in their hands. She made Samson sleep on his knees, and she called a man and had him shave off the 7 braids of his head. Then she began to abuse Samson, and his strength left him. She said, "The Philistines are upon you, Samson." And he awoke from his sleep and said, "I will go out as I have time after time and shake myself free." For Samson did not know that the Lord had departed from him. Then the Philistines seized him and gouged out his eyes, and they brought him down to Gaza and bound him with 2 bronze chains. And he was forced to be a grinder of grain into flour at the mill in the prison. He was destroyed by someone so close to him just because of money. Another pertinent example is the life of Judas. Judas was the one keeping the purse. He was the treasurer of the group and was stealing from the purse. He was already a prepared vessel to be used of the devil to betray Jesus. John 12:3. Then Mary took a pound of very expensive perfume of pure nard, and she poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was going to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" Now he said this not because he cared about the poor, for he had never cared about them, but because he was a thief, and since he had the money box serving as the treasurer for the 12 disciples, he used to pilfer what was put into it. He felt entitled to what was given to Jesus. He wanted it all to himself. A sense of entitlement will always breed greed. It was easy for the devil to enter into him, as stated in Luke chapter 22 AMP. Now, the festival of unleavened bread, which is called the Passover, was approaching. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to put him to death, for they were afraid of the people who listened devotedly to his teaching and who respected his spiritual wisdom. Then Satan entered Judas, the one called Iscariot, who was the one of the 12 disciples, and he went away and discussed with the chief priests and officers how he might betray him and hand him over to them. They were delighted and agreed with him to give him money. So he consented and began looking for a good opportunity to betray Jesus to them, at a time when he was separated from the crowd, because the people might riot or stop them from seizing him. While he was still speaking, a crowd came, and the man called Judas, one of the 12 disciples, was leading the way for them. He approached Jesus to kiss him. And Jesus said to him, "Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss?" When those who were around him saw what was about to happen, they said, "Lord, should we strike with the sword?" Ambition-driven betrayal. David was betrayed by one of his counselors, Ahithophel, because of inordinate ambitions. He wanted to remain relevant in the palace and thought that the best way was to betray his king to achieve that goal. He joined forces with Absalom and gave him evil counsel, all in a bid to ensure that Absalom would become king in place of his father. 2 Samuel 15:12. And Absalom sent for Ahithophel the Gilonite, David's counselor, from his city Giloh, while he was offering sacrifices. And the conspiracy grew strong, for the people with Absalom increased continually. David was told, "Ahithophel, your counselor, is among the conspirators with Absalom." David said, "O Lord, I pray you, turn Ahithophel's counsel into foolishness." He was ready to pull down someone he had served for so long just to have more influence and power. Forced betrayal. Forced betrayal happens under some sort of duress. Usually, the idea to betray you isn't planned, but could be triggered by blackmail or threats. But we must know that no matter what we have, to take a stand for God and righteousness. For even a man can hurt the body, he cannot hurt the soul, as only Jehovah has power over body and soul. Peter was forced because of fear to deny Jesus. He saw the treatment meted out to Jesus and fear gripped him. Luke 22:55. After they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and had sat down together, Peter sat among them. And a servant girl, seeing him as he sat in the firelight and looking intently at him, said, "This man was with him too." But Peter denied it, saying, "Woman, I do not know him." A little later, someone also saw him and said, "You are one of them too." But Peter said, "Man, I am not." After about an hour had passed, another man began to insist, "This man was with him, for he is a Galilean too." But Peter said, "Man, I do not know what you are talking about." Immediately, while he was still speaking, a rooster crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter, and Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had told him, "Before a rooster crows today, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly, deeply grieved and distressed. Peter wept profusely because at that moment he realized that he had let down the only one who saw something great in an ordinary fisherman. The great news is that his repentance granted him mercy from the Master. Jealousy-induced betrayal. Joseph's brothers betrayed the trust and bond of brotherhood by hurting him and selling him into slavery. The betrayal came because of jealousy that had morphed into hatred. They were jealous because of the great dream he kept having, and also because they could see how much their father treasured him. Genesis chapter 37 describes this. Joseph's brothers were envious and jealous of him, but his father kept the words of Joseph in mind, wondering about their meaning. Then his brothers went to pasture their father's flock near Shechem. Israel, Jacob, said to Joseph, "Are not your brothers pasturing the flock of Shechem? Come, and I will send you to them." And he said, "Here I am, ready to obey you." Then Jacob said to him, "Please go and see whether everything is all right with your brothers, and all right with the flock. Then bring word back to me." So he sent him from the Hebron Valley, and he went to Shechem. And when they saw him from a distance, even before he came close to them, they plotted to kill him. They said to one another, "Look, here comes this dreamer. Now then, come and let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits, cisterns, underground water storage. Then we will say to our father, 'A wild animal killed and devoured him,' and we shall see what will become of his dreams." Now Reuben, the eldest, heard this and rescued him from their hands and said, "Let us not take his life." Reuben said to them, "Do not shed his blood, but instead throw him alive into the pit that is here in the wilderness, and do not lay a hand on him to kill him." He said this so that he could rescue him from them and return him safely to his father. Now, when Joseph reached his brothers, they stripped him of his tunic, the distinctive multicolored tunic which he was wearing. Then they took him and threw him into the pit. Now the pit was empty, there was no water in it. Then they sat down to eat their meal. When they looked up, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead, east of the Jordan, with their camels bearing idenim resin for perfume and balm and myrrh, going on their way to carry cargo down to Egypt. Judah said to his brothers, "What do we gain if we kill our brother and cover up his blood murder? Come, let us instead sell him to these Ishmaelites and Midianites, and not lay our hands on him, because he is our brother and our flesh." So his brothers listened to him and agreed. Then as the Midianite and Ishmaelite traders were passing by, the brothers pulled Joseph up and lifted him out of the pit, and they sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 shekels of silver. And so they took Joseph as a captive into Egypt. Lust-induced betrayal. Lust has definitely pushed some people to betray trust, and this comes as rape, sexual assault, and even child molestation. The victims of this kind of betrayal never thought their pain would come from people they trusted. Forcefully take advantage of innocence or vulnerability, they lure people into traps. 2 Samuel chapter 13. Amnon was so frustrated because of his half-sister Tamar that he made himself sick, for she was a virgin. And Amnon thought it impossible for him to do anything to her. But Amnon had a friend whose name was Jonadab, the son of Shimma, David's brother. And Jonadab was a very shrewd, cunning man. He said to Amnon, "Why are you, the king's son, so depressed morning after morning? Will you not tell me?" And Amnon said to him, "I am in love with Tamar, my half-brother Absalom's sister." Jonadab said to him, "Go to bed and pretend you are sick. And when your father David comes to see you, say to him, 'Just let my sister Tamar come and serve me food, and let her prepare it in my sight, so that I may see it and eat it from her hand.'" So Amnon lay down and pretended to be sick. Tamar went to her brother Amnon's house, and he was in bed. Then Amnon said to Tamar, "Bring the food into the bedroom, so that I may eat it from your hand." So Tamar took the cakes she had made and brought them into the bedroom to her half-brother Amnon. When she brought them to him to eat, he took hold of her and said, "Come, lie with me, my sister." She replied, "No, my brother, do not violate me, for such a thing is not done in Israel. Do not do this disgraceful thing. As for me, how could I get rid of my shame and disgrace? And you will be considered one of the fools in Israel." But he would not listen to her. And since he was stronger than she, he violated her and lay with her. His lust made him do something so horrible to someone that trusted and loved him, enough to care for him in his sick bed. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for opening my eyes to see what betrayal means and showing me how to recognize it. I ask for grace to forgive everyone that has ever betrayed me so that I will not carry these painful burdens in my heart for the rest of my life. I also ask for your mercy in any way that I betrayed those that trusted me to watch out for them. Thank you, precious Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.